Penguin Random House Audio presents The Happy Vegan, A Guide to Living a Long, Healthy, and Successful Life by Russell Simmons with Chris Morrow. Read for you by Black Ice. This book is dedicated to the billions of animals who know nothing but horrific abuse and a brutal death. My prayer for this book is that it can help relieve at least some of their suffering, as well as the suffering of Mother Earth and her inhabitants, who are poisoning themselves by ingesting death on a daily basis. The Happy Vegan. All of my books at their core have been about the same thing, how to be happy. In fact, that mission has been at the heart of everything I've tried to do in my career. When I wrote Do You, Super Rich, and Success Through Stillness, it was only to help readers become happier. Just as when I made records with Def Jam, clothes with Fat Farm, and videos with my latest company, All Def Digital, ADD, it's only been to bring a little more joy into people's lives. I'm always thrilled when someone comes up to me on the street and says, "Russell, Do You help me get through a tough time?" Or hearing Run DMC change my life. It feels great to know that I've contributed, even just a tiny bit, to a positive change in someone's life. But as cool as it's been to get that sort of feedback, I'm expecting a different kind of reaction to this book. No, The Happy Vegan won't just change your life, it can save your life, not to mention save the world as well. That's a big claim, but it's made with a confidence that can come only from experience. Becoming a vegan hasn't only made me much happier, but healthier too. It helped me disconnect from the lifestyle that was making me sick, a lifestyle that has put too many other middle-aged African-American males in the ground. Today, on the verge of my sixth decade, I feel content and centered, full of energy and appetite for all that life has to offer. I'm in a wonderful space, and I credit much of it to my decision to stop consuming animal products. It's a space, however, that took a long time to arrive at. As those of you familiar with my story already know, I spent much of the first half of my life abusing my body with various toxins. From weed to coke to angel dust, there wasn't a drug I didn't get high off of. Just as there wasn't a kind of meat or dairy I didn't consume. Products that were in many ways just as bad for me as drugs. I finally got sober at the age of 30. In my late 30s, I embraced the practice of yoga, which helped me leave my toxic lifestyle behind me for good. In literally my first class, I experienced a sense of serenity and clarity I'd never felt before. Yoga helped me see that getting high had been nothing but a distraction. I found I preferred waking up sober to going to bed high. Yoga, in turn, led me to meditation, which taught me how to further wipe the distractions out of my mind and focus on my best ideas. My personal relationships and business began to improve. Instead of walking around in a daze, I was looking at life through cleaner lenses. It was a great way to live. Thanks to that clarity, for the first time in my life, I also found myself starting to think about the food I was putting into my body. During my yoga classes, my teacher, Sharon Gannon, or one of her disciples, would gently but firmly remind us not to put toxins in our bodies. Every day after class, it seemed, I'd meet someone who followed Sharon's mantra and had removed animal products from their diet. Inevitably, they were in great shape and smiled a lot. I was impressed. I was also inspired by my great friend and current head of television development at ADD, Simone Reyes, who had been a vegan for many years. Another big influence was Glenn E. Friedman, my senior executive in charge of television development at Def Pictures. Through their collective examples, I felt myself inching closer toward a healthier relationship with the world. I finally took a great leap forward on New Year's Day 1997. I was staying on the Caribbean island of St. Barts, where I love and still love taking a month-long vacation during the winter holidays. Glenn, as he often does, was staying with me at a villa I'd rented by the island's clear blue ocean. I woke up New Year's Day planning on hitting the beach, but a peek out the window at the overcast sky told me Mother Nature had other ideas. So Glenn and I decided to watch a movie instead. For months, Glenn had been bugging me to watch a film called Diet for a New America. Once I watched it, he promised I'd stop eating animal products and never look back. In my heart, I knew he was probably right, just as in my heart, I knew the yoga community was right too. I was primed to make a change. Yet for some reason, I'd been resisting watching the tape. Giving up drugs and taking up yoga and meditation had been a major transformation for me. Changing what I ate on top of all that seemed like just a little too much to think about. Glenn is nothing, however, if not determined. It's probably one of the qualities that makes him such a great photographer. He brought the film with him to St. Bart's in case such a moment would present itself, and now that it had, he wasn't going to miss his chance. "Russell, stop BSing and let's watch this," he said. "There's nothing else to do today. Nobody is going to be on the beach. The stores are closed and all your friends are sleeping off hangovers. Enough with the excuses. Today's the day." I knew he was right. "Let's do it," I said. Glenn popped in the VHS tape. Remember those? And I quickly learned that Diet for a New America was a PBS special hosted by John Robbins, named after the best-selling book he'd written a couple years earlier. John's father had co-founded the Baskin-Robbins ice cream empire, and John had grown up eating a normal American diet, heavy on meat and dairy. After a series of illnesses, Robbins took a closer look at his diet. After years of research, he came to the conclusion that meat and dairy were actually responsible for many of his health problems. He then dedicated his life to spreading the word about the dangers of consuming animal products. As the tape rolled, I was struck by Robbins' profiles of men in their 30s and 40s who were on the verge of death because of the damage meat and dairy had done to their cardiovascular systems. Men who frankly looked a lot like me. A doctor spoke about how one of his patients, a man in his early 30s, dropped dead one night after eating a burger and a milkshake. His body just couldn't take the abuse anymore. That really affected me. I'd had a lot of burgers and milkshakes over the years. I was also shocked to learn the degree to which the meat and dairy industries were responsible for polluting our nation's waterways and contributing to global warming. Equally powerful were the scenes showing the horrible conditions animals are raised in and the barbaric ways they're slaughtered for their meat. I had always subscribed to the fairy tale that animals lived on farms, grazed in the sun, and ate grass. Watching chickens being thrown into grinders alive, cattle squirming on squalid floors after having their throats slit, and caged pigs desperately trying to reach their piglets was the rudest of awakenings. After one such scene, Robbins said something that struck me to my core. "As a concerned citizen, as someone who wants my life to be a statement of compassion, when I see what's done to the animals, it makes me look at my food choices in a whole new way. I have to question, is that what I want my contribution to the world to involve?" The tape rolled on, but Robbins' words had already led me to an epiphany. No, I didn't want to be involved in the torture and slaughter of animals anymore. No, I didn't want to drop dead in my 40s from eating too many burgers and milkshakes. No, I didn't want to contribute to the destruction of the environment. Yes, I did want my life to be a statement of compassion, which would be impossible as long as I was complicit in the torture and murder of billions of animals. "That's it," I told Glenn the moment the tape was over. "I ain't eating this shit anymore." Granted, that's not the most articulate way to announce a major life decision, but it was how I felt then, and it's how I still feel to this day. I ain't eating this shit anymore. I hadn't woken up that morning planning on becoming a vegan, but from that moment on, I was going to work at changing my life for the better. There was no turning back. Before we go any further, however, I want to address a very simple but important question some of you might be asking. What exactly does being a vegan even mean? The most basic definition of a vegan is someone who doesn't eat any meat, dairy, or fish. That means avoiding obvious products like hamburgers, chicken wings, pork chops, and scrambled eggs, as well as some that might not be so obvious at first. For instance, a plain slice of pizza isn't vegan, because cheese comes from cows, though you can get delicious vegan pizza, more on that later. Just as ice cream isn't vegan because it contains dairy, or marshmallows aren't vegan because they contain gelatin, which is made out of the hooves and shins of horses. This might sound like a New Age philosophy, but people have been warning against eating animals for thousands of years. The Lord Buddha said, "The eating of meat extinguishes the seed of great compassion." The Greek philosopher Plato was a vegetarian who noted that the more meat a society eats, the more doctors it needs. Leonardo da Vinci rejected eating meat, as did the great Russian novelist Leo Tolstoy, who wrote, "Flesh eating is simply immoral, as it involves the performance of an act which is contrary to moral feeling, killing." Gandhi didn't eat meat either, telling his followers, "I do feel that spiritual progress does demand at some stage that we should cease to kill our fellow creatures for the satisfaction of our bodily wants." the concept that a fully compassionate and healthy lifestyle required removing not only meat but also dairy from one's diet first gained traction in England shortly before World War II. At that time, 42% of Britain's cows had been found to be carrying tuberculosis. A group of concerned vegetarians decided to form an organization alerting people to the dangers of dairy. The group's founder, a woodcutter named Donald Watson, came up with the name the Vegan Society. Vegan, he said, was meant to refer to both the beginning and end of vegetarian. Veganism picked up steam over the next few decades. Following the war, dairy production as well as chicken, cow, and pig farms became highly industrialized.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.